scientists, and particularly physicists, because physicists are the prototypical scientists, after all, view the world. And it is different than what you're used to. But it is an essential part of understanding how we take this complicated world, this incredibly complicated world of diverse phenomena, and make it simple. Simple enough to at least try and answer some questions and make some predictions. So, I want to do an experiment I once did for the leaders of the free world. And it was very depressing. So I'm going to drop the book and the piece of paper. Okay? Which is going to hit first? Book, okay. You sure? Okay. Okay, we got that right. Now, the key question is, why did it hit first? Now, I'm not even going to ask for the answer because some of you, I don't want to embarrass some of you, and others will be so proud you know, it doesn't matter. But 50% of the leaders of the free world told me this hit first because it was heavier. Now, that's sad because, in fact, about 450 years ago, Galileo showed us that wasn't the case. Now, many of them learned it in school and went in one ear and out the other because it was written on some board. But in fact, he also provided a demonstration of that fact, which I now will do. So I'm going to take the piece of paper and do this. It is no heavier than it was before, but it falls at the same rate. Now all of those leaders of the free world will remember that fact, because the only way to really learn anything is to be confronted by your own misconceptions, which is why you are going to learn so much today. Because much of what we view the world as being is a misconception. Namely, what Galileo did by that experiment is he abstracted out all the stuff that makes motion so complicated. The fact that the piece of paper does all sorts of crazy things when it falls down, and the book did some crazy things too, are things that are red herrings that get in the way of what's really happening. And the trick of science is to try and abstract out the unnecessary stuff to find out the necessary stuff. And there are a bunch of tools we use. So that's what I want to talk about today. And by the way, that simple abstraction changed everything. That was the first result that made the world modern. That was the first result of modern science, that everything falls at the same rate. And of course, you could say everything falls at the same rate due to gravity, and that led to Newton to do what he did. But just from that simple observation that not everything falls at the same rate. Everything falls at a different rate. But all the reasons are irrelevant. So how can you find out what's relevant and what's not relevant? Okay, those are the tricks. So I began one of my books with a joke, which is one of the few physics jokes, so I will tell it to you. So this farm is having problems with the milking of its cows and not producing enough milk. So it's a reasonable thing for a British audience. And so they call in some experts, some consultants. They call in an engineer, a psychologist, and a physicist. Okay, and they each spend a week looking at the stuff, and then they come make their reports. And so the first report is the engineer. He gets up and he says, well, you know, I've studied things. If you made the milking tubes about 15% wider, the milk would flow more quickly, and that would certainly help the efficiency of the farm, et cetera, et cetera. Fine. Then the psychologist comes in and says, you know, I think we should paint the barn green because it's a very peaceful color. Their cows will be happier, and they'll produce more milk. And then the physicist comes in and asks for a blackboard, or in this case, a whiteboard, because there aren't any blackboards anymore. So and he says, assume the cow is a sphere. Okay. Assume the cow is a sphere. There goes my joke. Assume the cow is a sphere. That's what you're supposed to laugh at. Okay? And because that's so typical. But in fact, it is incredibly typical that assuming the cow is a sphere seems so ridiculous that it's almost funny, although not even many of you even smiled. But it's actually useful. Because, in fact, assuming the cow is a sphere could tell you a tremendous amount about the world. For example, we can ask the question, why are cows the size they are? Now, that's a complicated question of biology and all sorts of stuff. But, in fact, we can go a long way towards answering it by assuming the cow is a sphere. Now, in order to answer the question, we have to do some things that will require knowledge on your part. So we'll work on that. So why aren't cows twice as big? So let's assume we have, because this is a small thing, let's assume this is the regular cow. Why don't we have super cows? Why don't, in England, why don't they breed super cows that are twice as big? Because after all, you know, more meat and all the rest. So let's think about this. Okay, to understand this, we say, okay, let me ask two things about this sphere. The sphere has a radius r. And that's a great thing about a sphere. It's only described by one number, its radius. That's it. Once you've done it, you know everything there is to know about it. Okay? So what's the volume of this sphere? Well, that's not so bad. Pi r cubed, did you say? It's close. But I don't care about pi's. But you should know, because in fact, you're trying to remember where the pi's and what. That's not important. Let's think of what volume is measured in. Give me a unit of volume. Cubic meters, cubic inches, cubic miles, cubic centimeters. So what's centimeter, a unit of length? And therefore, what's cubic centimeters? Cube. So all you have to remember is that the volume of something is, if it has some characteristic size r, the volume of it is proportional to r cubed. And sure, there are pi's. Actually, you weren't right. It's 4/3 pi r cubed, but that doesn't matter. I don't give a damn about the pi's here, as you'll see. Okay, good. Now let's ask, what's the surface area of that sphere? They're trying to remember where the pi's are. Forget the pi's. What are units of area? Anybody? Give me a unit of area. Have you ever bought a carpet? What? Square meters. So what do you think the volume is proportional to? See, you're already beginning to think like a scientist. Okay. Great. So, yeah?
Is it a sphere or a circle?
Sphere. I can't draw a sphere very well, but it's a sphere. I can do this. There we go. Now it's a sphere. Okay. Now, good. Okay, so let's ask, if this r is 1 here, then the volume of this is 1 and the area is 1. But let's ask what the volume of this would be. Well, this is twice as big, so this is 2r. So the volume of this is 2 cubed times the volume of that, which is 8. Okay? The area is 2 squared, which is 4. So I've increased the size by 2, but in fact the volume is increased by 8, the area by 4. Now, what holds a cow together? Skin. Skin holds itself up against the mass of the cow. What's the mass of the cow proportional to? Its volume. The more cow, the heavier it is. Right? So a super cow weighs 8 times more than a normal cow, but its surface area of its skin is only 4 times as big. So that means the pressure on the skin is twice as great. And in fact, that is the case. If the super cow is made of the same stuff as a normal cow, the laws of physics tell you can't make a super cow because the pressure is twice as big. The skin will fall apart. Now, see how much you learn from just a sphere? Now, if I drew a cow, a real cow, it would be damn hard to ask that question, because how the hell can you calculate the volume and area of a cow that looks like that? But the same is true. It turns out it doesn't really matter. It depends upon its shape. The volume would be 8 times big. The area would be 4 times as big if I increased all the linear dimensions by 2. So I don't need to worry about all that crap, the head and the tail, and I don't know which is which. Do cows have tails? Yeah, they do. I've seen them swat the flies. That's right. Okay. You're all supposed to know this. So I don't need to know that. A sphere works pretty well. So making a cow as a sphere tells us that in fact, cows can only be a certain size, not because of that part of biology, but because of a simple scaling law that you just didn't need to worry about all the details of what makes a cow a cow. But it can even get better. I want to tell you that, in fact, assuming a cow is a sphere explains why the dinosaurs became extinct. How? Okay, well, let's refine our model of a cow and make it a little bit better, because this doesn't really look like a cow. So let's call a cow 2 spheres. connected by a rod. That looks much more like a cow, right? So now let's do the same thing for a super cow. Well, we know that I don't need to draw the thing that's twice as big, but if I make it twice as big, what do we know? We know the mass of the head of the super cow is 8 times the mass of the head of the regular cow, because it's twice as big, right? If I make a sphere that's twice as big, it's 8 times as massive. Now, the rod, the strength of a rod depends upon its cross-sectional area. If it's made of the same stuff, and it's a rod of area, this area, if I make the area twice as big, then it's twice as strong. Okay? So the cross-sectional area of this rod, which I could otherwise call a neck, is 4 times big. This tells you something. This tells you if I scale up animals, I can't scale up the head at the same rate as I scale up the body because the neck can't hold it. So if I make a really big animal, it has to have a small head. That's why the dinosaurs went extinct. Because in fact, they couldn't have heads that increased in proportion to the size of their bodies, and their heads are pretty small, and they didn't know to stop smoking. No, they didn't know to... I have a little T-shirt that says that. It says, Mommy, that's why the dinosaurs went extinct. But in fact, they weren't very smart. In fact, they were not able to avoid the calamities that occurred by hiding in the appropriate places when a meteor hit the Earth. The little teeny mammals, the little rats and things, could hide under the appropriate places, creating an evolutionary niche out of which you arose. Okay? So we now understand why land animals that are very large have to have small heads. We also understand why the largest-brained animals in the world live in the water. They can't live in the land because if their heads are very big in proportion to their body, the neck breaks. But you put them in water, which makes them buoyant, you can have a really big brain, as dolphins do. So the largest-brained animals in the world live in the water just because of this, because of this. So now just think, we learned all of this about biology without knowing any biology, because you don't need to know any biology. All you need to do is think of a cow as a sphere, or two spheres. And so with a very simple approximation, which is ridiculously simple, so simple that even though you weren't laughing, you were thinking of laughing when I told that joke, we just think what we've learned. We've learned an incredible amount about the world. So that's the prototypical example of approximation that we do in science. And we'd approximate until we don't get the right answers. And then we know we throw in the baby out with the bathwater. So the idea is to try and just think of the universe as a sphere, which, by the way, is a good approximation. In fact, you could try it out in lots of different ways. For example, we think of the sun as a sphere. There, I'll draw it for you. Okay. Well, of course it's a sphere. But think about it. There's 100 billion hydrogen bombs going off every second in the sun. It's an incredibly complex and amazingly turbulent environment, you would think. But it looks round. So what we can do is assume, in fact, that the sun is a sphere, and in fact, that the properties of the sun just depend upon where you are from the center of the sun. That it's basically the same everywhere, and the density just depends on the distance from the center, and all the other part, the temperature depends upon the distance from the center, and all the rest. And a ridiculous approximation, you would think. But if you do that and then solve equations for taking a gas and making it a perfect sphere and putting it together, you can ask, what are the properties of the sun? And then you can test it, because we can actually understand the properties of the inside of the sun by looking at how it rings. The same way we find oil on Earth. We used to have an explosion, and we'd watch the seismic waves go through the Earth, and we'd learn about the density of the Earth by how the waves travel through it. So that's how they used to search for oil. Now, there are other more sophisticated ways, but one way was just to do an explosion and learn about the density of stuff underneath you by the weight at which sound moves. And if the density changed, it wasn't rock, it was probably oil. We can do that, and in fact, the sun rings in a beautiful way and allows us to measure, in fact, the density and temperature inside the sun, and we can build a model of the sun, and it's almost perfect. It's almost perfect. It's so perfect, in fact, that when there were predictions, the sun does one thing that's pretty neat. I don't know if I have time to talk about it, but it's something you should know and think about tonight when you're trying to sleep. The sun produces a lot of light, but what it really produces are neutrinos. Neutrinos are my favorite particles in nature, I'd say. They're very exotic. They're very ghost-like. Neutrinos interact so weakly with you and me that they go right through the Earth without knowing you're there. In fact, a neutrino emitted from the sun would go, on average, through about 20,000 light-years of lead without stopping. So it really doesn't notice things very much. But that is very interesting. Every second of every day, 10,000 billion neutrinos are going through every square centimeter of your body coming from the sun. And during the day, they're coming down. But at night, when you're sleeping, think of this. Tonight, they go up through the earth, up through the bed, and up through your body. So as you drift off tonight, think of those neutrinos coming through your body. It'll help. Okay, now, that was a prediction. So it turns out these neutrinos are emitted in nuclear reactions in the core of the sun, which is, by the way, how we know the sun burns, has nuclear reactions. Well, we knew it, but one of the predictions was these nuclear reactions produce these weird particles called neutrinos. And we calculated using this beautiful model of the sun as a sphere, and when actually a heroic guy built an amazing experiment to look for neutrinos, because you think, how the hell can you look for neutrinos? They go right through the Earth without even there. Okay, we use the laws of probability. Most neutrinos go right through the Earth without knowing it was there. But every now and then, if there are enough of them, one will stop or interact. So this guy named Ray Davis built a detector with something like 10,000 tons of cleaning fluid. Put in a deep mine underground, a deep mine, so because all the other particles that come from space would get stopped by the rocks except for the neutrinos. And you could predict, based on physical theories of the type I discussed in the very first lecture, in fact, that on average of those billions and billions of neutrinos, and you're too young to remember Carl Sagan, but you're not. But he used to say billions and billions. That was his characteristic. Of the billions and billions of neutrinos that go through that detector every second, you can calculate that once a day, a neutrino would hit the nucleus of an atom of chlorine, because cleaning fluid has a lot of chlorine in it, and turn it into the nucleus of an atom of argon. So all you have to do is detect a single atom of argon in 100,000 gallons of cleaning fluid. Now that sounds funny. You're laughing. That no science fiction a writer would suggest, but Ray Davis did it. He built the experiment, but the problem is he only got a third as many neutrinos as we predicted, which is a problem. Now, what's amazing is you might think, and the particle physicist said, well, what do these astronomers know? I mean, the sun is a sphere. Give me a break. It's obviously some crazy astrophysics. And the astronomer said, no, it works so well, describes the temperature, the density, everything else we see can't be wrong. For 25 years, that debate persisted. I actually wrote a lot of papers on both sides of that when I was trying to solve that problem. And it turns out that, in fact, amazingly, what we discovered is an amazing property of neutrinos. That neutrinos emitted by the sun change on the way to the Earth. So the neutrinos emitted by the sun are not the same ones that arrive on the Earth. They do what are called oscillations, and they change from one type to another. And that type that they change into has a probability only one-third as great of interacting in the detector. And that's an amazing fact. It means it's neutrino tells us these neutrinos have mass, which is not allowed in the standard model. It's an incredibly important discovery, which won a Nobel Prize. Two Nobel Prizes. In physics. One for Mr. Davis, just before he died. So it is amazing that this simple approximation was so good that in the end, a result which didn't agree with it turned out to tell us some new physics rather than that. So simple approximations work very well. And we're going to learn how to approximate. The way we understand this gestalt, the way we can then simplify the world, involves something that you hate a priori, numbers and math. But of course, numbers and math are much easier than English and much more precise and give you much more information. And it's a language that the reason you hate it is that you were taught math by mathematicians or math teachers, which is even worse. But The only way to understand numbers is the way physicists think about them, because then, you know, numbers have a lot of baggage attached to them. But baggage is both a bad thing and a good thing. It's very useful if you're traveling rather than carrying all your clothes like that and having to fall out. And it's the baggage that physicists and scientists attach to numbers that make them incredibly useful to understand the world much more quickly than you would understand otherwise. So let's do this. So the first thing about a number is that we don't write numbers the way you're used to writing numbers. And I alluded to this a little bit in the last lecture. I have a number which I'll represent by A, and I multiply A by A, and what do I get? I get A squared. And if I multiply A by A to n times, I get A to the nth. Okay? You okay with that? If I call 1 over A to the minus 1, okay, then 1 over A times 1 over A n times is A to the minus n. Now, this is incredibly useful because of the following simple property. A to the nth times A to the mth equals A to the m plus n. So multiplication turns into addition. Okay? Most of you can add. Some of you can multiply. Okay? And that simple, I mean, that sounds stupid, but that simple thing changes the world. Because, of course, as I told you before, in powers of 10, we can write, so 10 to the nth is a 1 with n zeros after it. And 10 to the minus n is decimal place with n zeros and then a 1. I mean, I'm sorry, the 1 in the nth decimal place after the point. Okay? So it's nth decimal place. Good. But this means that we can write every number in a way that's different than you write numbers normally. Every single number can be written as follows. K times 10 to the nth. Any number. Where K is a number between 1 and 10. Okay? Now, this may sound trivial. We call this n the exponent here. It doesn't really matter. But it is profoundly important for many, many reasons. First of all, it tells you the overall scale of the number. For example, if I write the number 1. What does that mean to you? Absolutely nothing. Because it's a big number. We know that. Okay? It's a big number. But if I write the number 1.52 times 10 to the 11th, then that tells me that 10 to the 11th is a 1 with 11 zeros. It happens to be 100,000 million. But it's 10 times bigger than a number that's 10 to the 10th. And so the minute I write this, I immediately know the overall scale of the number. And such numbers are trivially easy to work with. Which leads to us to our first pop quiz. Yes?
Isn't that called standard?
It's called standard scientific notation. I mean, it has names, but names are unimportant. Richard Feynman's father taught him when he went out in the woods. And he was looking at birds. A lot of people like to name birds. And Feynman asked his father, "What's the name of that bird?" And the father said, "Doesn't matter. What do you know when you know the name of that bird? You know nothing. Let's watch and see what the bird does, how it eats, what it does. Then you'll learn about the bird. The name of the bird doesn't mean a damn thing. Names are arbitrary." You know, I think we were talking about T.S. Eliot. I forget the poem. He says, "Words slippery and slide away," and they're just words. Words are imprecise. Numbers tell you everything. Anyway, but let's go to a pop quiz. Speaking of that, get out a piece of paper. You have, put your name in the top because you don't have much time. Okay, ready? No talking to your neighbor. Okay, you have 5 seconds. What's that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Time's up. Hand it in. Okay, well, don't hand it in then. I don't give a damn. I wasn't going to grade it anyway. I was just going to do what I do to all things, which is throw them down the stairs and see which one lands at the bottom and give it the highest grade. Okay, so obviously it's impossible to do that calculation in 5 seconds because that's because you're used to wanting to know more information than you need to know. So if I write this number instead as 2.3 times 10 to the 2 times 5.6, say, times 10 to the 2, then what do? Then this becomes two different bits of multiplication, both of which you can do. Because 10 to the 2 times 10 to the 2 is addition. 10 to the 2 times 10 to the 2 is 10 to the 4. And most of us can multiply numbers between 1 and 10 reasonably, approximately. So this is a little bit bigger than 2. This is a little bit bigger than 5. 2 times 5 is 10. 2 times 6 is 12. So it's a little bit less than 12, except that's a little bit better than 2. So I'd say it's something like 12. So this is 1.2 times 10 to the fifth. Now, maybe it's not 1.2 exactly. Maybe it's 1.18. But who the hell cares? Because I guarantee you, if you multiply this out for me, so this, by the way, 10 to the fifth is 100,000. So for example, say this was your pay, $232 an hour for, or pounds an hour, for 556 hours over the course of a year. Okay? Well, it's 120,000 pounds. So now maybe if you're estimating what you should earn during the year, it's 120,000 pounds. And maybe you'll actually only earn 118,000 bucks. But I guarantee that you, that some fraction of you, and I won't pick on you because I didn't ask if you'd actually do it, would get 1,000, 10,000, a million, some number that's vastly different because you'd forget how to carry the numbers and do all that stuff and get it all wrong. Now, that would be very bad if you estimated your pay as 10,000. So getting this number not exactly right doesn't make a hell of a lot of difference. Getting that number right makes all the difference. So when you write numbers in scientific notation, you can, as it's called, you can do amazing things. Now, in fact, I'm going to do something in a slightly different order because for some reason I'm in the mood. Let's do another. This won't be a pop quiz, but this is a poll. How long, let me see what numbers I'm going to ask for you to do. How long would it take you to count, hold on. I want to do a poll. And I want you to give me your answer just based on gut instinct. So I'll give you the possibilities. 1 hour. 1 day, 1 week, 1 year, 10 years, 100 years, and 1,000 years. How long would it take you to count to a million? How many people say 1 hour? You got to vote quickly. 1 hour? How many people say 1 day? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. How many people say 1 week? 10. How many people say 1 year? 2. How many people say 10 years? Come on. This doesn't add up to the number of people in this class. I can even see that. There are not 17 people here. Okay. Well, maybe 100 years? Okay. 2. Brave people. 1,000 years? 2. Okay. So you can see we have a distribution here. Now, the point is we can actually determine the answer by using scientific notation to do what's called an order of magnitude estimate. Because if all we care about is the order of magnitude of the answer, then we can make the mathematics very simple by writing things in scientific notation, which I was going to do in front of me, but anyway, because I move things around here, I don't know where it is, but I'll do it myself. Oh, here we go. So let's do the I'm jumping a little bit ahead of myself here, but I wanted to just show you. So, because this is how you win money in bars. You ask people questions and you get the right answer very quickly. So we can figure out. So let's estimate that it takes us 1 second to remember. Okay? So there's 60 seconds in a minute times 60 minutes in an hour times 24 hours in a day times 365 days in a year. So how many seconds in a year? Yeah, what?
Don't we have to allow for some sort of increment? Because it takes longer to say 900,000 than it does one.
Yeah, true, but it takes less than a second to say one, two, three. So average it out. Okay. No, it's not. It's a good thing. It's, you know, and the point is, but so if it takes 2 seconds, I'll be wrong by a factor of two. Okay, if it takes a half a second, I'll be wrong. I'm not going to be wrong by a factor of 100. Okay. But anyway, let's just do this quickly. 60 times 60 is 3,600, which is 4,000. 24 is 25. 4 times 25 is 100. That's 10 squared. 365 is 400. That's 4 times, well, actually, since I overestimated that and I overestimated that, let's make that 3. I'll make that small. 3 times 10 squared. So this is 3 times 10 squared times 10 squared times 10 cubed, so that's 10 to the 7th. We've now learned that there are roughly 30 million seconds in a year. In fact, the actual number turns out to be extremely close to pi times 10 to the 7th, 3.14159. If you do it, it's like 3.14, something like that. So now you can always remember there are pi times 10 to the 7th, or 30 million seconds in a year, but that tells us the answer. And most of you had good intuition in this case, right? It takes a little over a week because there are 50 weeks in a year. 1/30th of a year is 1 million. And so we now know, without having to guess wildly, we now know it would take you about a week if you didn't eat and you counted for 24 hours a day, et cetera, et cetera. Now, this is rather interesting because now I can ask, how long would it take to count to a billion? Now, these are useful things because most people don't understand big numbers because they don't have any sense of them. When I taught at Yale, I was aghast. The first year I taught a class for American Studies majors in science. And I asked, what's the population of the United States? Well, actually, I didn't ask that because who cares? I asked the question, how much water would be flushed in all the toilets in the United States in a given hour? Because that's a physics question. In fact, Enrico Fermi, when they were building the atomic bomb in the Manhattan Project in Chicago, said that physicists should be able to answer any question. And he gave these kind of problems, called Fermi problems, in lunch hour. And that's a Fermi problem. How much is water flushed in all the United States in an hour? Is something that if we hadn't just done what I did, you'd walk out and say, who the hell knows? But now you can estimate it. How many people in the United States, how much water in a flush, how many times you go to the bathroom in an hour, et cetera, et cetera. And a logical series of algorithms with some orders of magnitude estimates will give you a reasonable answer. As we'll see in a second, because I'm going to give you, we'll do something and then you're going to have an assignment. So I asked them how much water is flushed, and I turned out I got a variety of answers, and I discovered that most of the people, well, not most, the largest percentage, 35% of my students, American Studies majors, and thought the population of the United States was 10 million. Now, this is a remarkable fact, given they lived 60 miles away from New York City, which has a population of something like 14 million itself. And the United States would be a very different country if it, in fact, actually a large percentage of them thought it was 1 million. The United States would be a very different country with 1 million. And I got really upset about this level of ignorance. But then I realized it's not ignorance, it's just large numbers have no meaning. And it's because people aren't used to thinking about them this way. Well, I mean, a billion is 1,000 times a million. And if you work it out, well, that means a billion would take 1,000 weeks, which is 30 years. So I think that politicians should have to learn this by counting the money they spend. And then they'd understand that a billion's a big number when you're spending it, 30 years. A million is a week. But again, all those simple things you can do just because of scientific notation. Now, I've gone out of order because I wanted to do that. Before we get to something that's maybe a little more useful, you might find a little more useful, and you'll be amazed that we'll get the right answer. I always am every time we do it. I want to discover some amazing things about the world that you would think would never be possible to be discovered. But first I want to ask, okay, when I wrote this down, when I wrote down a scientific, when I write a number down in scientific notation, it has that, it has two things. It has that exponent and that number between 1 and 10. And it's really important to think about what those things mean. So if I take the number 1.2 times 10 to the fifth, that's the exponent. But that's that tells me something about that number. For example, if I write the number 1.4596 times 10 to the 13th, is that a very precise number? Is that a very accurate number? How many people think yes? One. How many people think no? Oh, interesting. Why do you think no?
Because you have all those zeros?
Well, because there's a lot of numbers that you're not saying here, right? There's a lot of numbers, so it looks like it's not very precise. On the other hand, I defy you to make a measurement of anyone's length and height in this room to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 decimal places. Try and measure your height in centimeters or meters to 5 decimal places. You'll never do it. There's no apparatus that you have in this room other than a laser beam, which you don't have, which would allow you to do it. Yeah?
I could measure kilometers to 5 decimal places.
Ah, okay, good.
It depends on scale.
Well, yeah. And in fact, it depends on scale. It turns out this is in units of centimeters, which we'll get to in a second, the distance to the sun. Okay? Now, what's interesting about this is you might say, is that an accurate number? Well, in fact, it's weird because if you think about it, the uncertainty is, so this is 10 to the 13th, 10 to the 12th, 10 to the 11th, 10 to the 9th, 10 to the 8th. So the uncertainty is this number, the fact that there's a number there means that basically my uncertainty is plus or minus 10 to the 8th centimeters in this number because I don't know whether there's a 9 there or a 1 there after that, right? Well, I do know it's not. I don't know if it's a... if his real number is 0.65 or 0.74, okay, but I'd round both of them to be 6. So my uncertainty is 10 to the 8th centimeters. That's the size of the Earth. That seems like an incredibly uncertain number. Of course, it's not very uncertain because when I say what's the distance to the sun, it certainly depends where you are on the Earth. The distance to the sun from me is very different from, is at least 10 feet different from here than over here, if the sun's over there. And if I'm one side of the Earth and the other, then my distance to the sun differs by that much. But that doesn't matter. It turns out, if you wanted to ask, when will the sun rise tomorrow to the nearest second, and I'm not going to burden you with this, I thought I might. We could do it. Do the geometry of where the sun rises above the... Then this is more than enough accuracy. So the accuracy of a number, there's no absolute accuracy. The accuracy depends on the questions you're asking. If I want to know the distance of the sun, the difference of the distance of the sun from that room to that room, then this is not an accurate number. And at absolute scales, it certainly seems inaccurate. But if the only thing I'm interested in is navigation, knowing when the sun is going to rise above the horizon to a second, then this is more than enough accuracy. So the accuracy, numbers have no absolute meaning in physics science. They depend upon the questions you ask. Because a number, in fact, this is not a number. This number doesn't mean anything. It has scientific notation, it has this prefactor and that exponent. But there's one other thing that is a property of every number, and that's a unit. So as you pointed out, if it were kilometers, well, sure, I could measure a number better than that. If it were microns, millionths of a meter, then it might be something you couldn't measure. So the important thing about numbers is when there are, you know, numbers in physics mean something because they have a magnitude, they have an accuracy, and they have a dimension. They have a units. And only when you write all three do you mean anything. Because everything that matters in science comes from observation and measurement. If you can't measure it, it isn't science. And since measurements require you to measure things in terms of units, I don't measure this room and say, look, this room is 12. It's 3 Krausses. Okay? That's a unit. And so, before I know the meaning of a number, I have to know all of those things. And then I can, depending upon the questions I ask, I can determine how accurately I need to know the number. Do any of you have calculators with you? You have telephones. You probably never you've used your calculator on your telephone, but all your telephones have calculators on them, except for maybe yours. No, you have one. Okay. So here's another question. And then we'll do something that will also allow you to win money bars. And I think we'll do some things that I hope will amaze you, because it's amazing how much you can do for so little. And that's the whole point. As I was saying last night, I was at a debate in Ghent, Belgium, with Dan Dennett, who will be lecturing to all of you this January, who studies consciousness and neuroscience, and some philosopher. And I pointed out that the reason I do physics and not consciousness is physics is easy. Physics is easy. That's the whole point. You've been hoodwinked into thinking that it's difficult, but it's easy. If it were difficult, I didn't become a doctor because I couldn't memorize all that crap. My mother wanted me to be a doctor, but I couldn't, I didn't want to. But physics, you don't have to remember anything. You don't have to know anything because you can figure everything out. You don't have to, and you can figure it out with a simple set of tools. And the first is that approximation, learning to get rid of all the irrelevant details. The second is order of magnitude estimation, and that depends on accuracy. So so if you have a calculator, what can you determine for me this answer? Okay, I'm going to give you 2 possibilities for what your calculator will say. 2.7754482 or 2.8 times 10. Oh, sorry. Yeah, okay. Times 10 to the 1. Or 2 times 8 times 10 to the 1. So which does your calculator say? What's the right answer? It's good to use a calculator once. What? The first one, 2.7754383, that's right, that's what your calculator gives. Wrong! I thought I'd wake you up. Because the calculator's stupid. The calculator doesn't know what this means. If this number is 3.2, that means I know it to an accuracy of only 1 decimal place. Right? And that means if I multiply this number by that number, I can't possibly know the result to 12 decimal places, 8 decimal places. I can't, because this number could be 3.15 or 3.24. This is the right answer, because because the result depends upon the weakest link. Yeah? Well, I gave you how precise it is. I gave you 2 decimal places. Well, that's because mathematicians don't understand numbers. They don't understand what numbers really mean, which in the world that we actually live in, not the world that we'd like to live in or the world we'd rather live in instead of being a human. The world we live in is full of observations, and that's the world of science. The world we live in, trying to navigate the world around us, trying to decide what to do, what will work and what won't work, how to build a faster plane or how to save energy, requires us to think about the way the world actually works. And if we only have measured some quantity to 2 decimal places, then this is the answer. And the point I wanted to make, which I've kind of made already once with the counting to a million, is that what is really amazing is for almost every problem you ask about the world, you almost always only need to know things to one decimal place. The order of magnitude. Namely, you only have to know the exponent. You don't have to know the prefactor. You just have to know if it's 10 to the 12th, or 10 to the 11th, or 10 to the 5th, to know the gist of almost every problem. To get almost the right answer. To solve problems that you would have otherwise thought were impossible. To take what Galileo did for motion and take it to the rest of the world. And the problem I want to do for you, well, no, you're going to do it for me, actually. We'll do it together, and then some of you will check it. Is a very famous problem that Fermi gave it to his people building the reactor. When they were building the reactor, they had to decide, by the way, this was a really important calculation. When they were building the atomic bomb, when an atomic bomb went off, would it ignite the whole atmosphere and destroy the Earth? That was a real concern. And the point was that you needed to know a lot of nuclear physics, but you needed to actually, Fermi, you know, was able to do calculations like this to convince himself at a very basic level that it wouldn't ignite the atmosphere and destroy the Earth. And it didn't, as far as we can tell. Okay? So the question, that very famous question he asked in underneath that football field in Chicago, which is where the first atomic nuclear reactor was built, in my mind, I think the idea was that if anything went wrong, you'd just kill football players, there'd be no loss. But is how, he didn't put it this way because he was in Chicago, but the question I want to ask is how many piano tuners are there in London? Now, before this class, if I asked you that question, it would seem like a ridiculous question. It may still seem like a ridiculous question. But you'd say, how do I know? I need to Google it. I can't, there's no way I can know how many piano tuners in Chicago. But in fact, we do know how many piano tuners are in Chicago. And again, I could take a vote if I wanted to. But I won't, because I've already embarrassed some of you before. But it could be one of those. These are powers of 10. These are orders of magnitude. But we can all come up with an answer. First of all, let's do it. Let's do it. And I know that no matter what numbers you give me, the number is going to come out to be about the number that's about right. Okay? Because we can break it down to problems we know something about. And we can do an estimation that we know something about. Now, the first question, and this is the big question, is what's the population of London? What? That 10 million? Yeah, I'd say 10 million. I don't know. Anyone? Are you okay with that? 10 million is 10 to the 7th. Now, so to estimate how many piano tuners there are, you need to know how many pianos there are probably are in London. So first of all, we need to know probably how many houses there are in London, how many residences. So what's the average size of a family? Four, let's just say four. So the number of houses is the number of people divided by four. Okay? Now, here's the key question, and this is something that will be hard because you're educated. You're not a representative sample of the population. If I asked, for example, I tried this for first year last year, and I got an amazing answer. How many people here have pianos in their house at home? Yeah, see, a huge fraction. Okay. It's much larger than the average population, is my expectation. So let's guess, what fraction of homes have pianos in them? One-tenth is not a bad number. Here was half.
1 in 20.
You think 1 in 20?
Yeah.
Well, 1 in 20 is 1 in 10, as far as I'm concerned. No, seriously, so order of magnitude, it's the same thing. Yeah? Hold on, we'll get there. We're breaking it down to problems we can solve. Yeah, so okay, well, there's electric ones. Yeah, yeah, it's true. That's changed everything. Electric pianos don't need tuning. They just need new pianos when they go around. Okay. Okay, so 1/10, we'll say. Now, good question. So this is a number of and we could make it 1/20th if you want. We'll see what the difference is. So this is the number of pianos. Now, how often does a piano tuner, how often does a piano need to be tuned? Once a year, you think? Okay, that's probably an overestimate. How many of you really, well.
Twice a
Yeah, I mean, and for modern people, it'd be once a decade. What do you think? You like the factors of two.
I think, but there's a difference between how many people actually tune it, so probably every 5 years.
Yeah, maybe I would say once every 10 years might be a good number for on average. I think once a year, probably they need to be tuned. In fact, professional pianos need to be tuned much more than that. But the average household, I doubt, has a piano tuned once a year. And it's probably once every 5 years, but once every 10 years is not a bad number. What? Of course.
If someone plays 8 hours a day, it will need to be tuned once a year at least.
Absolutely. Unless it's the child that's playing 8 hours a day and it's the parent that's paying for the tuning. Because I suspect that that's usually the case. In any case, the bottom line is, you're right. Here's a question, and the answer is going to depend on it. But, you know, the answer we're going to get maybe once every year, once every 5 years, once every 10 years is going to vary at most by a factor of 10. But you thought this should be 1/20th, so this is bigger than you thought. And I'd probably say right. So let's just say once every 10 years. Okay? So this is the number of piano tunings, the number of pianos that need to be tuned in a year in London, if I'm correct. Okay, so let's see. This is 100. This is 10 to the fifth. This is, so this is 1 over 10 squared is 10 to the minus 2. 10 to the minus 2 times 10 to the seventh is 10 to the fifth over 4. So that's roughly 2 times 10 to the fourth. 20,000 piano tunings a year. Now, how many pianos do you think you'd have to tune a week to make a living as a piano tuner? I remember when we got a piano tuned, it's roughly, let's say here it's probably 100 pounds. Five is a good, probably 1,000 pounds a week is not a bad living. Okay, so this is the number of, this is the number of piano tunings in a year. Okay, so you need to... Well, let's just find the number of piano tunings that are in a week, okay? So there's 50 weeks in a year, right? 5 times 10 to the first. So this is 2/5, which is 0.4, times 10 to the 3. So this is 400. 400 piano tunings per week. Now, if a piano tuner needs to make 5, we'll just make it 4 because I can divide 4 into 4 much more easily. That means there are 100 piano tuners in London. Now, you know, I would say we probably underestimated this. People probably tune their pianos every 5 years, so there could be a factor of 2 here. 1/4 is maybe not a good number for families. They're smaller now in England. So I would say the number is probably going to be between 100 and 500 piano tuners. Your assignment is to find out before the next class. And I guarantee you that the answer will be somewhere between 100 and 500. But the interesting thing is, you know, I gave all those numbers to guess, and I guarantee you that if I'd asked you to guess, I would have gotten numbers between 10 and 10,000. But this is a number, we got an answer that's going to be right. The number is going to be a few hundred piano tuners. I would be very surprised if it wasn't. And we didn't know anything. We didn't have to do anything except think rationally about how to approximate the world and just use order of magnitude estimate. Well, let me say this. You're right, it depends on the question you ask. But I might ask the question, I want to create a piano tuners association in London, and I need to know what dues to charge in order for my association to rent a building to have a meeting once a month. Okay? The meeting building costs £1,000 to rent, so it would cost me £12,000 a year to do it. Well, I need to know roughly how much to charge. And if I know it to the order of magnitude, then I'm not going to lose or gain a lot of money. Okay, I mean this, and the other thing is, I think, if you go to a friend and ask them a number of piano tuners, and many friends, and ask them this number, And don't ask, and they won't think like physicists or scientists. You're going to get a range that's much, much bigger. I mean, you know, if I basically said I could be out by a factor of 2, so I mean, I will bet it's between 1 and 250, if that makes you feel better. But the point is, it's of order 100. It's not of order 1,000, it's not of order 10, and it's not of order 10,000. And that is an amazing result, which I can guarantee you will be right. It's closer to 100 than it will be to 1,000, and closer to 100 than it will be 10. And we didn't, as I say, we just guessed. But to get the key aspect of how many piano tuners there are, we just had to use order of magnitude estimation. We could use order of magnitude estimation to guess how many college professors there are in London too. And all these numbers that see all these questions that seem unanswerable without incredible research are answerable at a key level that tells you what you really need to know, which is the order of magnitude, just by simple order of magnitude estimation. And so some of you would come up with 100, some of you would come up with 500, depending on whether you use 1/20th or once per year. But on average, some of you are going to overestimate by factor 2 and underestimate factor 2 here. If I had all of you do this separately, which I could have done, I suspect we'd all get somewhere between 100 and 500. And that's what's amazing. But you are right. It's only as good as the input. So that's what Fermi meant when he said a physicist should be able to answer any problem. Not necessarily get the right answer. But what that means is come up with an algorithm to take a complicated, impossible problem and figure out how you'd go about to answering it. And then you make some estimates. And what's really neat, and maybe I'll end the class with it in a few minutes, is that when you get it right, it's nowhere near as interesting as when you get it wrong. Because when you get it wrong by a huge amount, it means there's something fundamentally different about the universe than you thought. And that is how most science is done. Most discoveries are made. By doing simple estimates, not detailed ones, coming up with estimates of what you think will happen, and finding the result to be dramatically different. Because it tells you there's something fascinating about nature. But you don't have to spend years researching in libraries the number of piano tuners that were born in this year or that year, or doing a historical study or whatever. And that's really remarkable. Now, in fact, that may not seem remarkable to you, but let me show you something else. I think I'll just do this one because it's kind of neat. It's one of my favorites. I did it in the book once. Yeah, good. I'll do this, and then I'll tell you about a Nobel Prize that was won because of exactly what we just talked about. Take a deep breath. This is really useful for a humanities school. Take a deep breath, let it out. Take another deep breath. Hold it in. Hold it in. Keep holding it. You're smiling, so you're not holding it in. Okay, but you breathe it out. Okay, good, okay. I don't know why I asked you to do that. I just want to see how long you'd hold it. But the breathing is interesting. Because what we're going to show you now is something that I hope you'll always remember for the rest of your life. Because it tells you about your connectedness to the world. Boy, what is with this crap? Anyway, every time you take a breath, you are breathing in at least 5 to 10 atoms of oxygen that Julius Caesar breathed out when he said, "Et tu, Brutus." Okay? Every single time you breathe in, you're breathing in some of the dying breath of Julius Caesar. In fact, every time you're breathing in atoms from almost everything that ever lived. Breathing atoms that Hitler breathed out. I like to think this because every time I'm at my desk, I like to think that every time I'm breathing in atoms that Einstein breathed out when he finished his general theory of relativity and did the dawn. It's also true, by the way, and we won't do this calculation, but you'll see from the calculation when I do this, not too surprising, that every time you, t- When I began one of my books, I pointed out that when my mother, whenever I used to get a glass of water, my mother would say, don't touch that, you don't know where it's been. She had no idea. Every time you drink a glass of water, you are drinking in some atoms of water, some molecules of water, from the sweat of your parents' coupling that made you. I hope it doesn't turn you off water. But every time you drink a glass of water, you're drinking in scuff that's secreted by every slimy thing that almost ever lived. So there's a great line that I wish I could remember literary quotes, especially when I haven't slept, from Macbeth. Remember when Macbeth, maybe you know the line, I don't know if you remember, the line where he's trying to clean their hands off. He says something like, wash this blood out. But you know, if I put my hands in the seams, I make the entire seas incarnadine. Do you remember it?
Multitudinous seas incarnadine, making the green one red.
Yeah, exactly. Beautiful. I knew there was a reason you were here. But it is true that if you pricked your finger and put a drop and went to the Thames River. And put a drop of blood in that river, and then went to the seaside next year and took a teaspoonful of water, there'd be atoms of that blood that you drop in the Thames River in there. So you would, the multitudinous seas incarnadine. By the way, in English that means you'll turn them red, right? Okay, so I find it amazing, but we can estimate it and show that it'll happen. Show that you're breathing in Caesar. And all of the other estimations work the same way. So you can learn amazing things about the world with just some simple estimation. So let's do this. So first of all, let's figure out the volume of the atmosphere of the Earth. Something, again, that would have seemed like an awful question. But now we know how to do it because we know how to do dimensional analysis and dimensions. Ah, damn. I use this crappy one, which gets me all... Okay. So, here's the Earth. Here's the atmosphere. What's the height of the atmosphere? Anyone got an idea? Is it a million miles? Is it a million kilometers? Is it 1 kilometer? 10 kilometers is pretty good. You know, it's like 5 miles high. That's how... Or 6 miles high. Planes fly close to that. Is that okay? 10 kilometers? So 10 kilometers is the atmosphere, 10 kilometers. And 10 kilometers, so a kilometer is 1,000 meters, and a meter is 1,000 centimeters. So a kilometer is 10 to the fifth centimeters. So this is 10 to the sixth centimeters. Okay? Now, how do I calculate the volume of the room?
A meter is 100.
Didn't I say 100 times 1,000 is 10 to the fifth? And 10 to the 5th times 10 is 10 to the 6th. I got it right. I may have said it wrong, but the numbers are right. Okay. That's okay. The numbers are right. How do I calculate the volume of the atmosphere? Well, that's a hard thing to do, but I can estimate it because I know, by the way, that volume is cubes. Therefore, volume has got to be cubic centimeters. I have a centimeter here, so I got to figure out some centimeter squared to multiply by. What do you think that I might multiply by? Well, remember, how we calculate the volume of a room, rectangular thing? The area times the height. So to calculate the volume of the atmosphere, I just have to sort of calculate the surface area of the Earth and multiply it by the height, and I'll roughly get the atmosphere. Forgetting pies and all that, maybe. Well, I don't really have to. What is the area of a sphere? Do you know it? I'm going to put the pies in here just for fun. Anyway, it's 4 pi r squared. We know it's r squared. A sphere of radius r is r squared, has an area r squared. It turns out it's 4 pi r squared. So now I, however, have to know the radius of the Earth, which is another hard thing to do, but you don't have to Google it because we can estimate it, I hope. So what's the radius of the Earth? Well, let me think. So what is the circumference of the Earth? The circumference of a sphere of radius r is what? Does anyone know? 2 pi r, remember that? So 6 times r. What's the circumference of the Earth? Well, we can figure that out by saying, if you don't, I mean, I happen to know the number, but if you don't, let's just think. How many people have flown in an airplane to the United States? Do you know how many miles that is, say, or how many kilometers? No idea? You don't get frequent flyer miles? Yeah, say about 3,000 kilometers. 3,000 kilometers. In miles, it's actually about 3,000 miles, but it doesn't matter. It's this side of the United States. The other side of the United States is 5,000, because the states is 5,000 miles. But we'll use kilometers. So 3,000. Now, what fraction of the size of the Earth do you think that is? Now, there's a way to know, and you're living very near the place that would tell us how to do it, Greenwich. What's the time zone difference between here and New York?
Five hours.
And how many? Hold on, wait. Hold on. So it's 5 hours. So it's 3,000 kilometers to New York, which is 5 hour time difference. And what? And well, yeah, okay. And what's the? How many hours are in a day? Okay. So 1/5. 5 hours is roughly 1/5 of the day. So that means if 3,000 kilometers is 1/5 of the circumference of the Earth must be 15,000 kilometers. Right? So 15,000 kilometers is 6 times the radius of the Earth. So that means the radius of the Earth must be something like 3,000 kilometers. Okay, we didn't have to do anything. You have the information you need to estimate it. It turns out to be within a factor of 2 that. So 6,000 kilometers is 6 times 10 to the 8th centimeters. Because a kilometer, I mind you, is 10 to the 5th centimeters. So it's actually 6,000, it's not 3,000, but I wanted to see how close we get. Yeah?
Doesn't that prove that just guessing doesn't work?
Factor 2. Isn't it? The factor 2 is not going to matter in how many atoms. If I get 5 atoms from Caesar instead of 3 atoms from Caesar, I'll be fine. Okay? The question is, are there any? In fact, let's make it 3,000. Forget it. In this class, the circumference of the Earth, the radius of the Earth is 3,000. We just defined it. We know the answer. Okay, so that's the radius, and 4 pi r squared. So 4, this is 3. 4 times 3 is 10. We all know. And then we have 3 times 10 to the 8th squared. And that would be, so. And that's 4 pi r squared. And then we have to multiply by 10 to the 6th to get, and the final answer is going to be in centimeter cubed. So 3 times 10 to the 8th squared. 3 times 3 is 10. And 10 to the 8th times 10 to the 8th is 10 to the 16th. So 10 to the 16th times 10 is 10 to the 17th times 10 is 10 to the 18th times 10 to the 6th is 10 to the 24 centimeter cubed. That's the volume of the atmosphere. It is very important to realize that you need to know something about the world. But a number of facts you need to know about the world are facts that most of you can, even if you don't know them, you can intuit them based on things you know. So you start with something you know and you work, it's like literature, right? You start with something you know and you build on it. You can't write a good novel if you've never lived a life at all. If you never had any experiences with human beings, you can't write dialogue. Okay. Good. What's the volume of a breath? Well, let's just say a liter. You know a liter? You can understand a liter. It's a liter of beer. Most of you know what that is. Okay. A liter is 10 to the cube, 1,000 cubic centimeters. Now, therefore, the fraction of the atmosphere in every breath you take is 10 to the 3 over 10 to the 24, or 10 to the minus 21. So every time we take a breath, we're breathing in 1/10 to the 21st of the atmosphere. Now, how many atoms in a breath? Now, this requires something that some of you may remember from high school, Avogadro's number. It's the only number I remember. Well, there are a few numbers I remember. What is it? You were forced to memorize it at some point. 6 times something, 6 point something times what?
10 to the 23.
Exactly. Forget the 6, yes. It's 6 point, I just remember 6. So there are six, Avogadro number tells us there are 6 times 10 to the 23 atoms, more or less, or particles in a gram. That's Avogadro's number. It's a wonderful number to remember. 6 times 10 to the 23 atoms in a gram. Okay? And now, a gram of oxygen has an atomic weight of 16 or something. So that tells you that there are roughly 10 to the 23 atoms of oxygen in a gram. And for a gas, at density, normal density, what's the density of a normal gas? 1 gram per cubic centimeter. So there are 10 to the 23 atoms in a cubic centimeter, 10 to the 23 atoms in a cubic centimeter. Okay, we're going to get too many atoms. You should have caught me there. 1 gram per cubic centimeter is the density of water, not the density of air. The density of air is 1/600 the density of water. The density of water is 1 gram per cubic centimeter. So I have to divide 10 to the 23 or so by the number of order 100. 10 to the 21 atoms per centimeter cubed of breath. But then when Caesar breathed out, he breathed out a liter of air. That's 1,000 cubic centimeters. That's 10 to the 24 atoms. He breathed out 10 to the 24 atoms, which then uniformly distribute over the atmosphere. And you breathe in a fraction, 10 to the minus 21, of the atmosphere. Therefore, by this estimate, you're breathing in 1,000 atoms of Julius Caesar every time you take a breath. Now, I could have gotten it wrong by a factor of 2, or 5, or 10. But I'm reasonably confident that I didn't get it wrong by a factor of 1,000. Every time you breathe in, you were breathing in atoms from Caesar's last breath, and the last breath of almost everybody. It takes about 50 years for things to sort of uniformize in the atmosphere. So everyone from 50 years ago before, every single human being, and every single, not human being, but every being, the tiny stromatolites that built up the oxygen in the atmosphere of the Earth. The Earth had no oxygen in its atmosphere when it was formed, which is very good, because if it did, you wouldn't be here. Oxygen is a poison. Oxygen is a poison to life because it burns. And if there had been oxygen in the atmosphere of the Earth, then all the material, that organic material that might have been on Earth, would have been burned before it could even build up to form living things. Life is just slow burning. There was no oxygen in the Earth's atmosphere. All of the oxygen on Earth was built up by tiny puffs from single-celled stromatolites and other beings over 2 billion years. Taking carbon dioxide and turning into oxygen. And every time you breathe in, any time, you're breathing in atoms that were of oxygen that were breathed out by those stromatolites. I have a picture of me and Lucy. Do you know who Lucy is? She's a cute little girl who lived 4.2 million years ago. And I had her skeleton in my hand at one point. And every time I breathe in, I'm breathing in atoms that Lucy breathed in before she died. But anyway, you see, with that kind of estimate, you can find out wonderful things about the world. Now, in the last few minutes, so you see how powerful, just simply orders of magnitude, approximation, and using dimensions, understanding that volume is centimeter cubed. That's the other thing that's wonderful. The reason people hate physics, there are many reasons, usually physics teachers, but the reason people hate physics is because they memorize formulas. But I told you I became a physicist because I didn't like to memorize things. Well, you don't have to memorize any formulas if you remembered units and dimensions. This is dimensions of length cubed, right? Length cubed. There are only 3 dimensions in nature: length, time, and mass. And every physical quantity in the world is made up of those. And therefore, if I want to remember a formula for something or think about an approximate formula for something, I don't have to remember the formula. For example, if I have an object accelerating at a rate a for time t, what's the distance it travels? Oh, God. What? Does any remember? Okay, well, this is a trivial thing. We can figure out. What's acceleration? Well, that's a little bit hard. But what are the units of velocity? Meters per second, kilometers per hour, length over time. So velocity is length over time. Acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. So it's length over time per unit of time. It changes by 5 meters per second every second. So it's length over time squared. Right? That's acceleration. Has units of length over time squared. So if I want to find the distance something that is accelerating over a given time, distance has units of length. So I want to find out length in terms of two quantities. Acceleration is in units of length over time squared. Time squared has units of time squared. So the distance something traveling at a constant acceleration is, it happens to be 1/2 at squared. But I know the answer. I know the formula without the numbers in front of it. But I know it's 1/2 at squared, not 1/2 a over t squared. And I've taught physics classes, and half the kids in elementary physics will do 1/2 a over t squared because they're trying to remember the formula instead of thinking what it means. And so you don't have to memorize anything in physics. And in fact, I was going to do a calculation for you that, again, is something that you would never be able to do. In fact, it's actually a third-year physics calculation in university, which is if I took a mass on a spring, a mass of mass m in the spring has a force constant of k, what's the period of the spring? God, that's a complicated calculation. Turns out if you do the dimensional analysis, you get the answer exactly right, but I'll save you from that. But the ultimate dimensional analyzers are physicists like me, particle physicists, because three dimensions are too many things to remember: length, mass, and time. Wouldn't it be better if there was just one dimension in the world, one dimensional quantity? By dimensions, I mean dimensional quantities: length, time, mass. Well, how could I make three into one? Well, I could do it by being Christian, I suppose. But but let's do it for real. Well, if there was some universal constant that related length and time, something that was universal, then they're not independent. Well, there is a universal constant, the speed of light. Speed of light is the same for all observers, I told you. So the length of my hand is 10 to the minus 9 seconds. Right? Because that's the amount of time it takes light to travel that length of my hand. And it's universal. So every length can be related to a time, okay? And so when I measure any length, I can do it in terms of a time. There's another constant in nature called Planck's constant that relates mass and time. And that means that whenever I try and estimate something, there's only one dimension. And I can make an estimate based on that dimension. So the length of my hand, as I say, is 10 to the minus 9 seconds, okay? Now, what's really great is physicists like me say, well, that's great. So length and time, the distance traveled by light is the speed of light times the time it travels. So if I know the speed of light and I know the number of seconds, I can calculate the number of meters. But units are free for us to invent. As I said, the length of this room is 3 Krausses. That's a reasonable set of units, as long as we all agree what a Krauss is. Okay? Maybe 4 Krausses. We'd have to try it. So physicists like me say, let's invent a series of units where C is 1. Then we don't have to remember numbers. So C is 1. And that's the set of units we use. C is 1. It's easy for me to say, I'm going to invent a unit where C in that unit is 1. And the other constant in nature, which is Planck's constant, I also set equal to 1, so I don't have to remember numbers. And then any time you give me a dimension, a quantity of mass, I can relate it to time. By using, and I can do it immediately because the numbers are the relevant numbers are 1 for me. So I actually know how to do this quickly. And here's the amazing thing. If I have an elementary particle of mass of the proton, and it's unstable, how long would I expect it to live? Well, how would I know? Well, it turns out if I relate its mass in grams or whatever, to a time, It turns out if I plug those things in, I get 10 to the minus 24 seconds. And indeed, when we go out and build accelerators and we look at particles that are unstable, that are the mass of the proton, they live about 10 to the minus 24 seconds. In 1973, all these people were looking for new particles in an accelerator and discovered a particle of three times the mass of the proton that lived 10 to the minus 21 seconds. Now, that may not sound too surprising. But as the observer said, it would be like going into the jungle and measuring and finding a species of human being that lives 100,000 years. Human beings live 100 years. That's the generic thing. That's the dimensional analysis estimate, the order of magnitude estimate for the lifetime of humans. But dimensional analysis tells us that particles that are unstable of the mass of the proton should live 1,000th as long as this particle lived. That was the discovery that was so surprising, that it forced us to develop a new theory of the interactions of particles called quarks that make up protons, which led to the Nobel Prize. It turns out something amazing about quarks is when they get closer together, the force between them gets weaker instead of stronger. And because it gets weaker instead of stronger, the force that produces them to decay is much weaker than you would imagine otherwise. It's the exact opposite of electric charges. It was totally unexpected. Something called asymptotic freedom, discovered in 1973, Nobel Prize in 2004. Dimensional analysis is interesting because we can estimate how things should behave without knowing anything. And when we find out the answer is wrong, it tells us there's something interesting about nature. So those are the tools, ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Those are the tools that we use to take a complicated world and are able to intuit and discover things about it that we would never imagine would be possible if we had to know everything exactly. And so those are the tools that we'll try and use in the remainder of the lectures here to understand things that you, and understand quantitatively, not qualitatively, quantitatively things that you never thought you'd be able to understand because you didn't take physics since you were 3 years old or whatever is the last time you took physics. Okay? And they can also be used, as I say, if you think about these tricks to win money in bars. Okay, thank you. Okay.